The atmosphere is changing now, for the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is
here. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day. You've given us such beauty outside. You've given us such beauty inside. This is a warm and loving part of your family. As we come out of this pandemic, please allow us to connect and reconnect with each other, become more a part of each other's lives, more involved with the church, more involved with each other. May we always remember that you are the reason that we're here. You want us to be your images here on earth. Let us honor that and bring glory to your name. In your glorious Son's name, I pray. Amen.
It's not my life to live. It's not my song to sing, and all I have is His for all eternity. It's not my righteousness, it's not my faithfulness. His for all eternity. And we will crown Him King of glory, crown Him Lord of all, crown Him King.
Crown him, Lord of all. Crown him. did, but my wife is already giggling, so it can't be good.
You'd like to meet us.
Oh, okay. Well, good morning, everybody. It's great to have you guys here. It's great to have everyone. Once again, I get a personal greeting from the audience. It's fantastic. So here we are, Connect. And this week, we just have praises. Could you please bring the next slide up? There we go. Look at that. All right. So praises, the blessings box is in. Thank you, Brenda, for your incredible idea. Thank you, Mike Black, for helping with the carpentry. Thank you, Chris Schubert, for getting the hole in eventually. I mean, you know, sometimes you got to replace wiring. but thank you very much for that.
Wait. People have been using it. We actually had to fill it up again the other day.
That's where I was going. It's on its first total refill, so it's already a blessing. And thanks to the Schuberts for providing food for that through the food bank. So it is already a blessing in our community. How awesome is that? Praise the Lord. Number two, the Wasses moved, and we had just an incredible time doing it because a lot of people from the church showed up and lent a hand. First of all, James, thank you, and all of the support you brought. But thanks to everyone who showed up and really just kind of made it not a chore, but a fellowship opportunity. We had a lot of fun getting to know your family a little more, too. So that's what happens. You know, even something like moving can be fun when... when you get everyone involved, and so praises for that. That was just a fantastic thing. And here is a shot of our high school group. Jim and I have been teaching this group of kids. There's a junior high group too, but I forgot to take the picture. So, but that's okay. We've got the cool kids from high school up here. Jim and I have been teaching them physics for the last 11 weeks, and. Being able to do that with a Christocentric message, really bringing the Creator back into creation, it has been such a magnificent opportunity. This small group here is about to get a whole lot bigger. We had 7 junior high students and 8 high school students. Next semester in the fall, we're going to have 19 junior high students and 15 high school students. Praise the Lord. Now, that's fantastic, but we didn't have the resources for it, so we were kind of like in a bit of a dead panic for a while. We really could only have handled 21 to 23 kids, and now they're throwing 34 at us, and it would have required a massive amount of money to bring our equipment up to the next level to handle it. And so, you know, we were praying and asking other people, and so we're funded. So praise the Lord for that. We got some funding from back east from some people who really supported this. The Lord is kicking down doors. And when Pastor and I are saying this is the year of connection, we mean it. God is making some incredible things happen. If you have an idea, this is the year, guys. Give it a shot. We have 3 Connect groups right now. We have another one I hear that's coming along the way that blew me away. That's going to be absolutely awesome. This is the year, guys. The Lord is working right here, right now. Amen? All right.
The wrath of God was placed. But let's venture in, because it's fascinating. Once again, no surprise, Chris, if I sat down and I would have taken notes through chapel prayer and through your class, I could just use all that you guys said in the message itself. Just incredible integration by the Lord himself when all these things tie together. The only thing I can't tie in, Sandra, is how the clock falling on you might fit in, but somehow it does. Somehow it does. We're in this absolutely incredible book of John, and I'll be honest, I'll own up to this. Not only did I leave my phone unprotected last week, there's something in John I didn't recognize until lately. It's the genius formula how he takes opposites and goes bang, and you have a truth that cannot be disputed about the Lord Christ. The Christocentric person that Pastor, what's your name again, Chris? Yes, was talking about. Yeah, Pastor Christian. This, yeah, so. Chapter 1 had John took two opposite cultures that the world could not put together, and he puts them together and proves the Christ in the Word, the Logos. In chapter 2, he takes two very separate accounts. You wouldn't even know there's a whole gospel in the middle of them. Just two separate accounts, one at the beginning of Jesus' ministry, one at the end, and you go, boom, there's the gospel. There's the proof of Christ in those two things. And he brings out the truth that, you know what, Christ is greater than religious law. Whether we're talking the Jews or we're talking about what happens in here, he's greater than that. And he's greater than human effort. Thank goodness. Thank God he's greater than human effort. So here we are. What's the formula this week? We're still in opposites. He's going to take two opposites and prove something to us about Christ and about the truth of God. Well, this week, we'll start here. Instead of accounts or cultures, he's talking, now he's down to two individuals, two people. And he's going to take two opposite people and he's going to teach us some things we must know. What people, what opposites? Well, you know, the reading of this, I'm behind the scenes information, this may be of interest to Kelly on this, is Kelly and Kathy went to a pastor's wife conference, women's conferencing that they just got away, and they did as pastor's wives, and it was great. So I said, oh, they're going to be dog tired when they come back, you know. So Kathy, gets home and starts, this happened, and so I'm thinking, you know, I usually have Kathy read my scripture, and I wasn't going to ask her this week. She'll be so tired. She said, how would you like to read something for me? So I did end up getting Kathy to read these. Nicodemus is the longer of the two stories, and we even slowed it down a little bit, but because I want you to concentrate in the word of who this man is, Nicodemus. And so we're going to show you him in Scripture.
Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you're doing if God were not with him. Jesus replied, very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. How can someone be born when they are old? Nicodemus asked. Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born. Jesus answered, very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it's going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. How can this be? Nicodemus asked. You are Israel's teacher, said Jesus, and you don't understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and we testify to what we have seen, but still, you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God.
Nicodemus, here's a problem, if I can give you a pet peeve I find sometimes in preaching, is we take people of Scripture, and if they're not like the main guy, we turn them into this flat, unidimensional character so we can get on our own stump and go. But I think John didn't intend that. I think John intended, he said, you need to know who these people are. You need to know this situation. Once you know that, then you're going to be ready to understand. Because the end, to be honest, of that explanation could be blah, 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 until you understand what's going on and who he's talking to and why he's talking that way. So let's go into it in a more serious way. Nicodemus, who is this guy? Well, first, he's top level in a religious culture. Judea is a religious culture. He is on the top of the heap. If we looked at the right word, ruler would be used, or archon in the Greek. And it simply means an individual who is the first rank of power. If you looked up the definition, it would say it is a person who is the first rank of power of whatever it is. If it was royalty, it would be the king. If it's democracy, it's the president. It is the ruler. So this guy is, in biblical terms, a big cheese. So we can look that up. That's in there. This guy's a big deal. He's no slouch. He's a devout, accomplished man. He's somebody you don't just casually talk to. Now, he's a Pharisee, and oh, we love, there's a code word. We bring up Pharisee, and there's somebody we can beat up on and feel all righteous about. But I want you to stop and think about this, is how hard-earned their elitism really is. Do you know, in the time of Jesus, it's estimated that there were 2.6 million Jews in Judea, in the Israel, in that area. At the most, there were 6,000 Pharisees. These guys were the elite religious people of a religious culture. They were not slouches. And Nicodemus is an archon in this culture. So if Pharisees are less than 3% of the culture, that means he's easily within 1% of the top of this culture. This guy is no slouch. And it's not surprising, really, since it's a religious culture, that wealth tends to tie in with the religion and the resources. He's well accomplished. He has money. There's no question. He has some money. But that's not a sin, is it? I don't mind if I have some money. I'm certainly not going to feel sinful about it, depending, I suppose, how you get it. But really, it's how you spend it or how you use it. That's going to determine things. And this is a point, it's almost incidental when I think how this is in Scripture. Nicodemus is one of the people who gave what was necessary for a burial. He gave for Jesus a mixture of myrrh and aloe. And we say, well, that's interesting. Must have smelled nice. But here's the thing. This mixture of myrrh and aloe was an absolute necessity and point of dignity for somebody of importance being buried. What really shows here is how much he gave. Now, the amount that Nicodemus gave for the burial of Jesus was something only seen for royalty. It was a ridiculous amount of a very expensive mixture. How expensive? Well, If we were to buy what Nicodemus used for Jesus in the burial, it would come to $200,000. Nicodemus put his wallet where his mouth was. This guy was no slouch. Now, keep in mind, that sounds like a lot of money for us, but keep in mind, this is also in a culture where the common worker earned pennies a day. This was a lot of money. That was a lot. But isn't it interesting in Scripture, there's no plaque to Nicodemus, there's nothing that says, oh, Nicodemus donated so much. Just the only thing that mattered is that he did. And that was the point. Scripture has different values than we tend to have even in churches today. But it brings us to another basic question, because, you know, that's the end of the story, right? That's what Nicodemus did at the end. But let's go back to the beginning of the story. Why did he show up anyway? Why did he show up to talk to Jesus in the first place? He was this guy with a lot to lose if he's going and talking to this revolutionary rabbi, right? He's already at the top of his career. He's doing well. He has money. He has status. He has all these things. He has a lot to risk in showing up talking to this person that's not all that popular with the establishment. And, you know, I can only come to one conclusion. Maybe you folks are smarter than I am on this, but I can only come to one conclusion. If he's willing to risk that much, he must have really wanted to know something. If he was willing to risk that much to see this Jesus who was the Messiah, he must have really wanted to make a connection with God that he wasn't making already. That's saying a lot. This guy's pious. He spent his whole life in church, if you will. And somehow he still needs to find God? Ever know anybody who's gone to church all their life and still needs to make a connection with God? Happens, doesn't it? So Nicodemus begins by acknowledging the signs. And John loves that word. We'll find it all through, because everything is a sign. Doesn't tend to use the word miracle. He uses the word sign. This is a sign that Jesus is really who he says he is. This is a sign that this is the Messiah. So Nicodemus starts off with that, and he says, by your signs we know you are something, maybe even the Christ. So here he is in the middle of the night talking to him, finding out. And Jesus, who we know knows the hearts of men, it's not even Nicodemus asks a question straight out. It's that Jesus, knowing the heart of men, begins the answer he needs. And he launches into some really, really heavy stuff. But this guy showing up in the middle of the night, let's just stop there for a minute. Why did he come, and why did he come then? Well, you know, a lot of times for a popular answer, we say, well, it was kind of a covert affair. He showed up in the middle of the night so that nobody'd know he was there. Maybe there's an element of truth to that. He had to watch out. I mean, he's checking out this Jesus guy. He's, you know, maybe he's not all he's supposed to. I don't know. So, maybe he shows up in the middle of the night. But here's something else that if you dig into it deeper, you find out, is that rabbis routinely did their heaviest thinking and discussion in the middle of the night. You know, you had your stuff going on all day, but if you were reflecting on something you were really wrestling with, you did it in the middle of the night. And that shouldn't surprise us. Most of us do that. We lay in bed and go, how am I going to answer this question? And that was also going on. Coming in the middle of the night to talk to, he was ready to give Jesus some serious attention. And I had a laugh when it struck me, and this is that as we beat up on these poor old Pharisees here, is that do we realize that one of the first people to have true quiet time with the Messiah face to face was a Pharisee? Yeah. maybe we need to live up to their standard. Maybe we could ask ourselves, do you have as much quiet time with Jesus as a Pharisee? And so this conversation unfolds, and Nicodemus is, it seems like he's being just stubbornly obtuse about this, is that, you know, what do you mean by that, Jesus? How can this happen? How can that happen? How can a man be born again? And can he come out of his mother a second time, type of thing? But as we dig in, we know that there's something going on here, because the idea of being born again, man, do we like to coin that as a Christian phrase? Do you know it's not a Christian invention? It's Jewish. The whole concept of being born again is comes from Judaism. The thing of it was is that as a Jew, you were born a Jew, so you were born. But let's say one of us riffraff showed up there and we wanted to convert to Judaism. We need to be born again into their family, into the Jewish family. So we were born again. How seriously did they take this? It was taken so seriously that you were given a new identity, that by law that you could actually even marry a sibling, because you were no longer that person anymore. You are an entirely new identity. The thing is, it was for pagan converts, so here's this Jewish, accomplished man who knows scripture better than anyone. He's no pagan, he's no convert, so how does being born again fit in with somebody who's that far down along the line? Born again fits in. There was just an incredible, if you haven't seen it, I'd recommend going back and seeing Pastor Chris's and Steve's Wednesday, this past Wednesday. Man, what a chapter. What a chapter, and what a job they did going through it. But they hit on a verse right around the middle of the chapter, Isaiah 32:15. Until the Spirit is poured upon us, the Spirit, capital S, poured upon us from on high, and the wilderness become a fruitful field, so fruit of the Spirit. Isaiah 32. 700 years before the whole Jesus thing even starts, here is talk of the Spirit being poured on people. The chapter's amazing as these guys get digging into it. The king, it starts with the king who is the bedrock and who makes us the bedrock, the very words used in the New Testament. It talks about the breath of God being poured out on them. The same thing Jesus talked about. It talked about the undeserving being transformed, and the concept of, guess what, being born again, the whole word play of it, all in there in the Old Testament. So that's nothing new for somebody like Nicodemus. This guy was the top 1% of the culture that wrote these words. He was not a dummy. So was he just being obstinate? Was just being stubborn about it? I don't know if he was resisting as he's listening, but I do come to one conclusion on this, is that when he showed up to see a literal Jesus. He showed up to see a face. He showed up to see a literal person. There was a presence. And when he showed up to see that person, he expected to hear literal wisdom from this individual. Wow, there's a cat. I got to love it, Kathy. One week it's me, and now it's you. Pastor's wife. Yep, the phones are evil. They're evil. Amen. We all agree. So, talking about literal sounds. So there's Nicodemus. He's looking for this literal answer or literal presence, literal signs, because that's why he's there. He saw them, tangible signs. There he was. So he was tied up in these concepts of everything being literal. I think he was even struggling with how literal does this get? And born again, how literal is this? Or is it just a metaphorical thing? Is it just something like, yeah, we say that it's kind of like a cool saying? No, the concept was real. And if he was struggling with this idea of just how real does this stuff get, I wonder if we don't struggle enough. I mean, take today. You came in here. You're going to church. It's routine. But how real is the idea of meeting the Lord God in here to you? How real is God, period, to you or me? This was some literal stuff, and Nicodemus was wrestling with it. So this idea of being born again is no small thing. And Nicodemus knew this too. It meant that all the old stuff that was you went away. It didn't mean the real you faded away. It just meant those things that were the trappings of this life, that old identity went away. And that's a pretty profound cost. How much are you willing to let go? That's a struggle continual, isn't it? Let go, and I don't just mean the nice stuff, I mean the bad stuff. Let go of the grudge. Let go of that attitude. Let go of things that have been hurting you all your life. Born again is a big deal. And that's why it becomes, when we understand all this, like Nicodemus understood this stuff. So when you get to the second half of that story Kathy was reading about the born again and the spirit like the wind and all of these things, this must happen. Nicodemus knew. Do we know? Do we know? Have we dug into it as deeply as he has? So that's where we are with Nicodemus, a well-educated, well-refined, good-thinking, deep-thinking man who found so much of the knowledge or the data, but was yet to find the truth. And that's why he was there in the middle of the night. There's person one. Well, who's opposite of Nicodemus? Well, let's see.
After this, Jesus and his disciples went out into the Judean countryside where he spent some time with them and baptized. Now John also was baptizing at Enon near Salem because there was plenty of water and people were coming and being baptized. This was before John was put in prison. An argument developed between some of John's disciples and a certain Jew over the matter of ceremonial washing. They came to John and said to him, "Rabbi, that man who was with you on the other side of the Jordan, the one you testified about, look, he's baptizing and everyone is going to him." To this, John replied, "A person can receive only what is given them from heaven. You yourselves can testify that I said, I am not the Messiah, but am sent ahead of him. The bride belongs to the bridegroom. The friend who attends the bridegroom waits and listens for him and is full of joy when he hears the bridegroom's voice. That joy is mine, and it is now complete. He must become greater, and I must become less. The one who comes from above is above all. The one who is from the earth belongs to the earth and speaks as one from the earth. The one who comes from heaven is above all. He testifies to what he has seen and heard, but no one accepts his testimony. Whoever has accepted it has certified that God is truthful. For the one whom God has sent speaks the words of God, for God gives the Spirit without limit. The Father loves the Son and has placed everything in his hands. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. But whoever rejects the Son will not see life, for God's wrath remains on them.
Well, as we look at this, I started trying to account through, even in my own mind, the difference between, because remember, the formula here is two opposites. And in this case, in this chapter, two opposite people. And, you know, there's a few things that's worth noting. It's, of course, John the Baptist did not write the book of John, so there's a good minutia fact for you if somebody ever throws that at you. But he also says himself he's not the Christ. So what do we know? Well, here's some certainties we can know. He is certainly the opposite of Nicodemus. Nicodemus is at the top of society. John isn't even in society. Nicodemus is a refined man of knowledge. John is just rough and raw and a man of action. Nicodemus is wealthy but desperately poor for one single truth that he seeks. John has the one single truth and little else. Nicodemus is great among men. John is great in the kingdom of God. Nicodemus is just a stranger meeting Jesus. John is a cousin who jumped for joy before he was even out of the womb. Nicodemus needs to become something more. John needs to become something less. Nicodemus is a Pharisee. John chastises Pharisees. The opposites just go on. It's remarkable. It's profound. It's wide. So, well, let's just dig into John a little bit. What did John do? Why did he do what he did? You know, it'd be an interesting question. Why did John do what he did? And if you look at it scripturally, the answer is real simple. For the joy of it. For the joy of it. He says so himself. There was a joy from doing exactly what God designed him to do and to be in that center of obedience and where and what and where and how he was supposed to be doing what he was doing. There's a lot of power and joy in seeing yourself and your purpose clearly. There's a lot of joy in seeing yourself and your purpose clearly. Now, I don't think Chris and Kelly will mind too much. I'm just going to touch on it. But I could just see the conversation. They went off to with our DS, our district superintendent, last week and had lunch after service last week. And Bob and Mary Kay have a way of finding out who you are. They do, don't they? And they're wonderfully dangerous. And I can just see how it went because I know Bob and I know Chris, and Bob getting on to what brought joy to Chris's ministry. And I could just see the table exploding and the conversation going on and the twinkle in Bob's eye when he said, okay, so how are you going to, what's your plans in the immediate future type of thing? And then going on from there. But, you know, why would Chris explode in this great dissertation probably on what he's doing is because, I didn't plan that, Chris, but that worked out really well. You saw it today. He came. Was he joyful about what he was talking about? Because he knows, if nothing else, and I'm not saying he doesn't, but it's the one thing he knows, this is an area God would have him bring Christ into young life. And he is uniquely, not quite a John the Baptist, don't bother wearing the sackcloth, I don't think it's your thing, but uniquely qualified, just like John, to take on that task. And it is amazing when, just one step, if you know what God would have you do, the joy that can bring. I found it even with this year. I mean, I'm dead serious on this. Is coming out of the 2020 thing, you've got one great mission, and that's to learn how to, again, to enjoy each other, to deepen the bonds of friendship and fellowship and growth and support in here so that others are attracted to us. Do whatever you can to build those bonds and do whatever you have to keep them from being disturbed. But build those bonds. Because I could guarantee you this too. If the doors of this church were to lock in a year or two and be closed, it will not be the budget. It will not be because of money. It will not be because you guys and me and whoever didn't work out the next winter program. It will be because we stopped connecting. It'll be because we stop taking one command seriously. It'll all start. Now, other things be involved? Sure. I mean, you just can't be silly with your money and your budget and all of that. But none of that is primary. It will be taking this one command seriously. And this is, I guess this takes us back to chapel prayer, Jim. Ephesians 4, 1 through 7. Sound familiar? I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Love the way you did that in there, stopping on the calling. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit. Not just unity. Unity of the Spirit. That big capital S, the thing that Nicodemus knows about. To keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. For another cup of Jack's coffee, or next week maybe Ray's, I don't know. What is peace in Hebrew? Shalom. And shalom means so much more than the English peace, because it's not just peace. It's the peace that God has put in you and then it spreads out. It's that kind of peace. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit. Just as you were called to be one hope when you were called. Did you know you were called? One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all, through all, and in all. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. You have your share. I have my share. What are we doing with it? When we understand what it is like, what it means that you have a clear vision, it may just be the next step of obedience. It may be just the next step in how you take this grace, your gift apportioned to you, and you're moving. Just the next step. But clarity brings joy. Man, does it bring joy. So then the statement John makes a lot of sense to us when we understand this. All this I'm doing, this joy of mine is fulfilled, so that my joy is fulfilled. What's the cost for John to see the joy? For him, it was this. He must increase, but I must decrease. He must increase, but I must decrease. You know, there are fewer lines that are more spiritually universal in Scripture than that simple line of John's. You think about this, this idea that he must increase and you and I must decrease. This is the basis for salvation, the basis of baptism, of sanctification. It's the key to how you grow in Christ. The building blocks of humility and obedience and transformation all come from this. Christ is just a silly facade unless you understand that line. Your church is nothing. Your Christianity is a hoax. If you don't understand, he must increase and you and I must decrease. It's a big line. If you're looking for joy, or you're looking to find out who you are, maybe it sounds backwards. He must increase. Well, what about me being me? I want to be me. Oh, who are you? Who are you really? Let me take a little scenario out for a test ride. Started with the extreme. And it's to come, a question may even seem philosophical. But imagine this. There's an individual, your loved one, whoever. They want to be them, so they want to experience everything that they can experience. Don't put limits on me. Don't give me those standards. And so off they go to experience everything, and lo and behold, genetics and everything else that plays into us, they find themselves addicted to something. A drug, alcohol, whatever. And they start following down that road until their life is saturated. This is the philosophical question I have for you. Is that person really themselves in the depths of the addiction? Or when they're free from it? What's the real one? Now, that's kind of easy, even though it's unfortunate. Let me give you something more subtle. How about somebody who's saturated with jealousy or bias or hatred or just something that you can pick it because you know what? Human nature, that's what we've got a stockpile. There's a big inventory of all the things a human being can do, feel, and think wrong. Just pick a choice. And saturate your life in that. For instance, let's just take jealousy. If a person is racked with jealousy and they start acting out of that jealousy, are they the real self? And when I say real self, I mean what they were designed to be, what will allow them to be a fulfilled human being. Are they the real self when they're saturated in the jealousy or when they're free from the jealousy? Yeah, it becomes pretty obvious because some of us, this stuff we know is that I'm sorry when I did that, I was not myself. You know, that type. We know the situation that could go. But there's a cost to being your real self and to feeling that kind of joy we're talking about. The cost is you must decrease and he must increase. The one who designed you must increase in that. Part of you that is so toxic must decrease. That can be some hard work and it can be some big sacrifice. Now, for John, he wasn't giving up the bad side of himself. It was kind of another thing for him is that, you know, the whole idea in church even is working yourself out of a job. If a church is truly healthy, what the whole idea is you're raising up somebody in your line of service, in your gift behind you, and to the point where God moves you on somewhere else, and somebody else is taking on that, and then the next thing you know, you've got servants running helter-skelter all over the church, and good things are happening. Oh, it's just chaotic. Amen. And that's what church is supposed to be, and that's what is going on there with John. He must decrease. Hey, I've done my job. Now the real Messiah, the Messiah, is coming into the picture. Two opposite guys. So how does it come to the same truth? The question, they're looking at Nicodemus and John. And how does it all apply to us? Well, let's start with what the cost is if we don't follow through. The Father loves the Son and has given all things into His hand. He who believes in the Son has everlasting life. And he who does not believe the Son? Interesting, the word for word, the transliteration in that is, and he is one being stubborn, shall not see life. But the wrath of God abides on him. The wrath of God abides on him. Breaking it down just real quick. The cost is this. They will not see everlasting life. Trick question. When does everlasting life start? No trick for you guys. There you go. What an unfortunate thing that people, Christianity is all about the afterlife. And you know, when you go, no, it's not. It's what's happening in you right now. If there's not a life of God starting to spark up in you now, then I'm sorry, you're cooked for later too. It starts now, everlasting life. He will never see everlasting life now or then who doesn't pick up this cost of becoming less for him being more. The cost is the wrath of God. The Greek word orge that is used here, there's a number of definitions as usual, but the one that caught me was the word violent passion. Violent passion. We usually don't have a good picture of that one. This kind of went through as a kind of a thread through the class and through the prayer as well, is this idea of who the Creator God is. The fact of, I think, Chris, that was a wonderful thing. It was even more fun watching faces when you were explaining how we sit in the middle between the quantum state and, of course, the macrocosmic state of things. That there we are in the middle. Like God makes really, 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 really small things and really, 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 really big things, and we're right smack in the middle. God created all of these things, and it says He sustains all of these things. So when God does something, it affects all of these things. We think we know terror now. We think we know from natural disasters. Just curious, anybody been up close and personal with a tornado? You're Midwesterners. Was it horrific? Was it a scary thing, Sherry? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I kind of like that. Yeah. Yeah, when you got thinking of it, it could have been you. When you start thinking of what
this thing could have done, and if you remember the show Tornado, I think that's what Scott came out, they said, what's an F5? Look at the finger of God. They said, the point is this, is that you know what a tornado is in the cosmic, that thing that Chris is talking about? It's the atmosphere burped. That's all it is. But for us, I mean, that's a big thing. When there's these horrible earthquakes, the crust of the planet shivered for a second. A little bit. That's all it was in the big scheme. I know it's horrific. I understand. This is what I'm getting at. If that is as horrifying as it is on the little scale, imagine when the Creator of all of this becomes violently passionate. I don't want to see it. And I certainly don't want to bear the price of it or the cost of it. I can't even imagine what that will be. But it is something we don't want to be involved with. That's part of the cost if we decide not to follow through with all of this. It's an amazing chapter, two opposite peoples, one great truth. It comes down to the truth of what it is. It'll cost you to follow this Messiah, and it will cost you not to follow this Messiah. And there is this ultimate outcome of what will happen. And in Nicodemus is on one end of considering this, and John is on the other end. And the truth is both, as we look at them together and what is going on. But there's one last thing about Nicodemus and John. I'm going to leave you with this one because it's a kind of subtle and kind of simple. Just as a thought, how old do you think Nicodemus was? 60s? 80? Could be. I mean, you know, the honest answer is I don't know, but you hit on it, no matter what, is that he was an older man. There's no way in this culture you reach that level of achievement without being an old fellow, an older man. Is it surprising maybe then that he showed up in the middle of the night to find out if this was really the Messiah? Because the one thing, other than his truth he was looking for, Nicodemus didn't have was a lot of time. He knew. He spent his whole life trying to literally connect with God, and he knows he doesn't have a lot of time. Here's another question. John the Baptist, how old was he when he died? Okay, similar. Time, yeah, I mean, yep, So it's going to be in the early 30s, no doubt. So being young didn't help either. Both men, there was a commonality. They didn't have much time. And that's part of it. Young man, old man, neither of them had much time. They had very little time to get this right on connecting with God the way they needed to connect, to be as tangible in their connection as they needed to be. I don't know if you see the uncomfortable question coming back here, but it's how much time do we have? How much time to get this right? Don't know. Hey, there's all young guys up front, hopefully long, long lives. They look good, look strong. Yes, just get compliments, but it's still okay. But who knows? So was John the Baptist. Some of the rest of us, I mean, I get mistaken for 25 all the time. Yeah. Yeah, three times. There you go. But I don't have that much time. I've been at this for a long time. Whatever I'm going to get right, I better start getting it right now. Whatever I'm doing wrong, I better correct now. Whoever I need to reach, I better reach now. Whatever thing God has got me moving in, I better do it now because there's not a lot of time. And guess what? I'm not alone. I know a lot of you look better than me, but there's not a lot of time. It's not a lot of time. When you go out from this place this morning, in your resolve, how much of there going to be in this? There's not a lot of time, and I must decrease so that he can increase. I must do this so my joy can be fulfilled. How seriously do we take it? Are we as literal as Nicodemus? It's just a basic question here, but if not now, when? Not now, when? We're just going to, there's only so much that can get done in this building. In this hour, there's only so much we can take to us. Then we go out here and do, or we don't do something with it. And we'll pay a cost to do it, and we'll pay a cost not to do it. Our choice, what will we do?
Please join me in prayer at this time. Dear Heavenly Father, time, whether we consider it in the human view or in your view of us, time is our most precious commodity. We don't know if we have one day, one hour, one year. It's all one lifetime to us. We ask that you, through your Holy Spirit, that you take this message that we received today and burn it in our hearts. Let us take it home and study it. Let us take it home and use it to become a blueprint for us. Let us become less and let you become more. People will see it. People will like it. And we're called to do that. Please, Lord, bless each and everybody as they leave here today. Give them the hearts to follow you. We pray this in your glorious Son's name. Amen.
Is only Jesus.
strange and divine. I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. The night is dark, but I am not forsaken. For by my side, the Savior, he will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need, his power is displayed. To this I hold, my shepherd will defend me through the deep.
Through Christ in me.